Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free 1 week trial. Just $4.99 a month for your all access pass. Playing now on Fandor is Miss Arizona. A former pageant queen makes a getaway with four unlikely friends when trouble shows up at their women's shelter. They embark on a wild all-night adventure through LA's darkest streets and wildest drag club.
What's up, guys?
Hey, what's up? Hey, what's going on?
Holy cow. I like this Zoom. This is exciting.
I was going to try to rock the mohawk today. Really glad I didn't.
Yeah, you got to save that line for when we start rolling.
Oh, come on, man. You got two mohawks on
the Zoom. Can't have two mohawks in the same Zoom.
I've yet to have another mohawk in a Zoom. So
all right.
Well, have you started rolling yet?
We're rolling right now.
All right, let's leave all that in. Welcome to another video Fandor podcast. Welcome, Chris Kelly.
Thanks so much.
Welcome, Bryn.
Thanks,
Bryn.
Thanks, guys.
And here is our amazing guest, Evan Jackson Leong, film director.
What's up, guys?
Before we get into your movie, I just want to say congratulations on making a film. It is so difficult. And what you pulled off, is just the fact that it's done in the can, being distributed, huge achievement.
Your film
is called Snakehead. What's it about and how did it come about?
Wow. So the movie is, the way I pitch it to people is it's like Scarface, but instead of a Cuban man, it's a Chinese woman. And instead of smuggling cocaine into the country, she's smuggling people. And, you know, this all takes place in New York Chinatown, and it's inspired by a true story of a woman in the 80s and the 90s in New York Chinatown, smuggling hundreds of thousands of Fujianese into America.
Wow. Okay. And, like, how did it come about? Like, why this story? Why did you find this? How did you find it? And then, like, why did you say yes to this?
I mean, you know, I think that's a big question, right? Because you know how hard it is to make a movie, right? And I learned early on that it's gonna be, you don't get many shots to make a movie. You get shots to make little documentaries, music videos, you get chances. But with the feature film, the amount of resources, the amount of time, all that comes into play, I was really, really set on trying to find the perfect story. The story that, you know, if I get one shot at making a movie, you know, which one will it be? And, you know, I'm a huge fan of Scarface and Godfather and, you know, the 80s and 90s. I think we all are, right, of these gangster films of that era. You know, even the Hong Kong and Yakuza films, right? And I always wanted to make one here in America, you know, with people that looked like me. And, you know, I never really got to see one that, you know, or a story that really got me excited about. You know, I mean, there's lots of sort of gangster films, but I needed something more. I needed something that could really get a hook and really got me excited. And, you know, when I heard about this woman who was this, you know, the boss of this underworld, I was like, this is, there's something here that's, you know, that goes beyond this, the standard tropes of, you know, greed and the American dream and, you know, family.
Well, we have an Asian guy on this podcast. His name is Bryn. He's from Vietnam. And Bryn, you saw the movie.
I did see the movie.
Well, tell your boy some
gotta use
your thoughts.
You're a token Asian guy in this podcast, right? You know, I'm the
token white guy. So
I must say it was a genuinely authentic Asian film. It was awesome. So I got to give you props for that. I noticed that when the girlfriend got mad, she said, "You grabbed my ass, old man." I was like, oh, man. As a Vietnamese guy, you use the Vietnamese girl as a total bitch. And I was like, that is so accurate. Oh, my God. That's perfect and very well done.
Well, thank you. That was definitely an element of authenticity there.
Uh-huh, exactly. And I got to mention arowanas in the fish tanks. You know, that's another big Asian factor there.
What's an arowana in a fish tank?
It's a kind of fish that we typically have in our homes, and they're a sign of good luck.
Okay. Oh, that's good.
In all restaurants, right. Homes. Yeah,
restaurants, homes.
Arowanas.
Exactly.
They're like water dragons, you know?
Uh-huh.
Well, I couldn't help but notice you cast Jade Wu. Mm. Now, anyone who watched Luke Cage on Netflix knows her because she's the bad guy. And from the trailer, it looks like she's the bad guy in your movie now. Is she? So it seems like she's being typecast as the bad guy in all the film. Am I right? Like, tell us about Jade and how that came about and all. Yeah, because I love her on the big screen.
I mean, I love Jade, and yeah, she's definitely cast as the bad character in this film, but you know, a complicated one, a complex one, one with lots of layers and lots of, you know, motivations that, you know, are a little bit more, they're deeper than just your classic, you know, I want to be bad. And, you know, it's interesting, right? I mean, Jade's been around for quite a while. I mean, she's been acting for 40 years, right? And she's an amazing actor, but, you know, this is the first time, you know, I talked to her now, and she's like, she's busier than she's ever been in her career. And I mean, it's a very interesting sign of the times that there's a lot more roles than there never were before, you know? And when I made, you know, I started this film 10 years ago, there was nothing like this at all.
Yeah. All right. So looking back on the movie, what would you have done differently?
I probably wouldn't take as long to make the film. Although, you know, I appreciate the struggle and the journey. You know, it took me about
the process can often be slow.
yeah, it can totally be slow. And I think, you know, I think once I decided to go just straight indie and crowdfund the movie, it really sort of picked up, and I was able to, you know, I guess as an artist, you know, you're able to control your fate, and that was quite exciting because it was just all on me. You know, I carried the weight this whole time without, you know, any investors or studios telling me what to do or how to finish it. So, you know, I think, you know, next time I think I would do a lot less action pieces on an indie film. Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about the film festival circuit. How was it received, and which like festivals did you put this in?
Yeah, I mean, you know, COVID really, really messed up the timeline for this film, right? We were supposed to premiere, I think, last year, right, at this in San Francisco. And then, you know, obviously that got canceled. And then when we got into Santa Barbara International Film Festival earlier this year, it was just so exciting because it was like a real industry sort of festival. And I was so excited because it was a drive-in. So, you know, watching your film for the first time with an audience is like the most nerve-wracking thing ever. But this time I got to watch the first time with the audience in a car and by with just my wife. So we were protected. We were having fun. And, you know, at the end of the film, people don't clap, but people honk, you know. And when you have 50 cars honking, it feels like you just won everything.
That's awesome.
That's great. That's really great. So when is it coming out? Where can people see it? Like, what's the website? Like, give us some of the deets here, because we want your movie to be successful. We care. This group cares.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this has really been a labor of love. So, you know, it's been over 14 years, and to me being here talking to you guys right now is truly, it's just a miracle, right? Because we know how many films get made and that no one ever sees, and, you know, be able to actually be in theaters, you know, this Friday, 10 October 29th, and, you know, on VOD, Hulu, Amazon, iTunes, you know, all those, the streamers. It's just truly, truly an amazing sort of opportunity. And I'm just humbled by this and excited to see the rest of the world, to see the film.
I'm going to the premiere on Friday in San Francisco.
Okay, cool. I'll be there.
Are you going to be there?
Awesome.
Yeah.
All right. I'll see if I can bring these two with me if they're free.
It's fun to watch on the big screen. I'm glad you're watching on the big screen because, we really it's a gritty film, so seeing it on the big screen is really the way to watch it.
Do you know how we're connected? Do you know who connected us?
Who connected? Brian.
Henry.
Oh, Henry. Wow.
Yeah. That's the reason we're doing this. One of your producers. And I think he's hosting he's screening that, right? He's the one hosting.
The 4:30 screening?
Perfect.
Yeah, no, I mean, I'm happy that he's doing his thing in the Bay Area, which is a hard thing to do.
You know what's great about you? You have real economy of words. You don't ramble. So we don't have to rush the end of this interview.
Fantastic.
That's a really good thing.
I don't got much to say, really.
Well, I mean, come on. Let's talk about how the selling of the movie happened. I want people who don't understand how the filmmaking process works to hear how it was after you made the movie, you put it in film festivals, and the selling process, and who ended up buying it, and what that meant.
Yeah, I mean, you know, when you go down the indie road, you basically make the film. You're kind of betting on yourself that you're going to make a film good enough that someone's going to buy it, right? And so, you know, you want to get it in a festival after you make the film, you know, which is an accomplishment in itself. But to get in a festival that's prestigious enough to get the buyers and basically distributors to, you know, see the film and see the response and see that they can, we can sell this through our, you know, distribution networks and make money off of it, right? And so at that moment, you know, the festivals that you're trying to get into is truly just a sort of you know, you're hoping. It's all hope, right? There's plenty of films that get into Sundance that don't ever get bought, that don't get distribution, you know, even at the highest level of Sundance. So for us, getting into Santa Barbara and then finding a buyer and finding a couple buyers that actually really liked the film and, you know, having a little bit of a bidding war was super exciting for us. And, you know, once we, Samuel Goldwyn, you know, picked us up, you know, then, you know, they kind of opened it up for us. They tried to change the game, you know, gave us a chance to really get sort of mainstream with the movie. And, you know, that's the ultimate goal of any artist, really, to just, you know, get your work seen by as many people as possible.
So did Samuel Goldwyn give you the best distribution, or did they give you the most money, or did they give you both? I want the truth
for once.
They gave me all that and more, right? We found a really good partner in them. You know, they actually, you know, this is not their first Asian American film, right? They put out Justin Chan's Gook, right?
Okay. Mm. Yep.
And so, you know, they knew that the Asian American market is something to, you know, deal with. And I think that was, you know, part of the reasoning. Plus the fact that, you know, I think Peter Goldwyn is, you know, we're on the same age. So we grew up on the same kind of films. And he really thought of this as like the next iteration of the American gangster.
That's great. A bunch of my former colleagues at Facebook were involved in Gook, and they formed a sort of Asian American Film Society of former Facebook employees have been helping fund Asian American films, and Gook was one of the ones that they're most proud of. So it's great that
Gook is great. Justin's great. I mean, it's a really exciting time for Asian American cinema. I think we're finally getting some work out there that's really you know, that's representative and also, you know, very powerful.
Yep.
Two more questions for you, and we'll cut you loose. One is, tell us two or three movies that really inspire you.
Two or three movies that inspire me. Well, I got a San Francisco one. I love Big Trouble in Little China.
Oh yeah, I love that movie too. When you look back at Kurt Russell and that film, are there Asian stereotypes in that bother you today?
I mean, there's a ton of stereotypes, right?
But are you okay with it?
I mean, you have Kim Cattrall in there, but the thing is, really, you know, what I realized later on watching that film, why I really connected to that film, is that the first time you see an Asian character without an accent speaking English, being a hero, right? Mm. And that's something, you know, I mean, for you, it's fine, but for me, I've never seen that before. You know, I mean, it's hard to say what other ones were, but you know, that was, you know, one of the first ones. And you know, I love the action. It was kind of fun. It made San Francisco Chinatown feel special.
It did. But you know what's so great about your answer here is there's always something to be offended by, but you're like, you know what, I'm not going to be offended. I'm going to remember how I felt when I watched that as a kid. I'm going to say it's a great movie. It touched me. It inspired me.
It's all about the context, right? I mean, if they made Scarface now with the Italian American playing a Cuban, like, that would not be good. You can't do that now, right?
Right.
You really can't.
You put Andy Garcia in that role, but you can't put.
But you can't. I mean, I think you know, it's all about context, right? And so, I mean, we're gonna get to a point where it's like, why didn't you know? Even with our film, like we talked about Snakehead, you know, Sung is full Korean, but he's playing this Chinese guy, and we're like, oh, his dad's Korean, so we'll play that. But you know, I mean, you know, it's something that's, you know, something that we kind of address to the context and what you're actually dealing with right at the time.
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting. Did you see Star Trek, the one with Chris Pine?
Yeah.
Who's the character that plays Sulu? We hung out with him at the airport.
Yeah, we hung out with him at the airport. It's
John Cho.
Yeah, exactly.
John Cho's Korean, right?
John Cho's Korean.
But Sulu was Japanese. And I remember how difficult it was for Paramount to have to kind of sidestep that and say, you know, is it okay if we cast a Korean who was originally Japanese? So, God.
Please. I mean, there's always the rules. I mean, I think ultimately it comes down to the character and how it's performed, right? If it's a great performance, then no one's complaining, right? If it's bad and there was a better choice for it, then, you know, then it's a poke at.
And then also a lot of it is just getting away from whitewashing that has gone on over the years and having white actors play Asian actors or you know, any ethnicity.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean, at the time, though, like when they put those white actors playing Asian characters, it was fine. Nobody was complaining back then, right? So it's a context, right? And I feel like as the consciousness gets higher and better, you know, we will see, you know, more diversity, more, you know, authentic roles. And, you know, ultimately at the end, I mean, it's all make-believe in the first place, right?
There it is. It's all everyone remember that. It's all make-believe anyway. All right, you want to give us one more movie before I ask you my final question that really inspired you? Come on.
I love In the Mood for Love by Wong Kar-wai.
Okay.
Oh.
All right.
What year did that come out, roughly? Do you remember?
2000.
Okay. In the Mood for Love. I've never seen it. I don't even think I've heard about it.
Incredible. Incredible.
Okay.
Tony Leung. Tony Leung. Shang-Chi. Tony Leung. Young Tony Leung. Well, that young. 40s. 40s young Tony. Because he's 60 now. It's just crazy.
And then lastly, what's next for you?
So I'm still doing a lot. I mean, you know, I mean, I'm just trying to embrace all this, enjoy this moment. You know, this is such a long journey. So at the same time, I'm developing a bunch of scripted stuff. And, you know, I've been a documentarian for the last 20 years. So that's where most of my work comes from. So, I mean, I'm doing a bunch of different sports docs right now.
Awesome. Oh, cool. All right, everyone. His name is Evan Jackson Leong. His film is Snakehead. It's out. There's a million ways to see it. Please support this guy and his dreams and his filmmaking so we can see him do another movie soon.
Thanks so much, Evan.
Thanks, brother.
Right on, Evan.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for tuning in. Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free one-week trial. Playing now on Fandor is Miss Arizona, a former pageant queen, makes a getaway with four unlikely friends when trouble shows up at their women's shelter. They embark on a wild, all-night adventure through LA's darkest streets and wildest drag club. That's Fandor, the home for cinephiles.